Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Track of the Cat by Nevada Barr, narrated by Barbara Rosenblat. This book is copyrighted 1993 by Nevada Barr. This recording is copyrighted 1997 by Recorded Books. The memory of violence and loss drove Anna Pigeon from the city to seek peace in the southwestern wilderness. A ranger in America's national parks, she is at one with nature in its serene, unspoiled majesty. And though nature can have a violent side as well, Anna thinks she knows the difference between the savagery found in beast and that found in man. And now, Track of the Cat.
Chapter 1. There hadn't been a god for many years. Not the nightgown-clad patriarch of Sunday school coloring books. Not the sensitive young man with the inevitable auburn ringlets Anna had stared through in the stained glass windows at Mass. Not the many-armed and many-faceted deities of the Bhagavad Gita that she'd worshipped alongside Hashish and Dustin Hoffman in her college days. Even the short but gratifying parade of earth goddesses that had taken her to their ample bosoms in her early 30s had gone, though she remembered them with more kindness than the rest. God was dead. Let him rest in peace. Now, finally, the earth was hers, with no taint of heaven. Anna sat down on a smooth boulder, the top hollowed into a natural seat. The red, peeling arms of a Texas Madrona held a veil of dusty shade over her eyes. This was the third day of this transect. By evening, she would reach civilization. People. A contradiction in terms, she thought, even as the words trickled through her mind. Electric lights, television, human companionship held no allure. But she wanted a bath, and she wanted a drink. Mostly she wanted a drink. And maybe Rogelio. Rogelio had a smile that made matrons hide the hand with the wedding ring. A smile women would lie for, and men would follow into battle. A smile and a thought, with habitual cynicism, that the practiced hucksters in Juarez flashed at rich gringos down from Minnesota. Maybe, Rogelio. Maybe not. Rogelio took a lot of energy. A spiny rock crevice lizard peered out at her with one obsidian eye, its gray and black mottled spines creating a near-perfect illusion of dead leaves and twigs fallen haphazardly into a crack in the stone. "I see you," Anna said, as she wriggled out of her pack. It weighed scarcely 30 pounds. She'd eaten and drunk it down from 37 in the past 2 days. The poetry of it pleased her. It was part of the order of nature. The more one ate, the easier life got. Diets struck Anna as one of the sourest notes of a spoiled country. Letting the pack roll back, she carefully lowered it to the rock surface. She wasn't careful enough. There was an instant of rustling, and the lizard vanished. "Don't leave on my account," she addressed the seemingly empty crevice. "I'm just passing through." Anna dug a plastic water jug from the side pocket of her backpack and unscrewed the cap. Yellow pulp bobbed to the top. Next time she wouldn't put lemon slices in. The experiment had failed. After a few days, the acid taste grew tiresome. Besides, it gave her a vague feeling of impropriety, as if she were drinking from her finger bowl. Smiling inwardly at the thought, Anna drank. Finger bowls, Manhattan, were miles and years away from her now. Molly and AT&T, her only remaining connections. The water was body temperature, just the way she liked it. Ice water jarred her fillings, chilled her insides. "If it's cold, it had better be beer," she would tell the waitress at Lucy's in Carlsbad. Sometimes she'd get warm water. Sometimes a cold tecate. It depended on who was on shift that day. Either way, Anna drank it. In the high desert of West Texas, moisture was quickly sucked from the soft flesh of unprotected humans. No spines, she thought idly. No waxy green skin. Nothing to keep us from drying up and blowing away. She took another pull at the water and amused herself with the image of tumbling ass over tea kettle like a great green and gray sticker weed across the plains to the south. Capping the water, she looked down at the reason she had stopped. The neatly laid pile of scat between her feet. It was her best hope yet, and she'd been scrambling over rocks and through cactus since dawn. Every spring and fall, rangers in the Guadalupe Mountains followed paths through the high country chosen by wildlife biologists. These transects, carefully selected trails cutting across the park's wilderness, were searched for mountain lion sign. Any that was found was measured, photographed, and recorded so the resource management team could keep track of the cougars in the park. Where were they? Was the population healthy? Squatting down, Anna examined her find. The scat was by no means fresh, but it was full of hair, and the ends twisted promisingly. Whatever had excreted it had been dining on small furry creatures. She took calipers out of the kit that contained all her transect tools. Camera, 5x7 cards with places for time, date, location, and weather conditions under which the sign was found, data sheet to record the size of the specimen, and type of film used for the photograph. The center segment of this SUS, standard unit of sign, was 25 millimeters in diameter, almost big enough for an adult cat. Still, it wasn't lion scat. This was Anna's second mountain lion transect in 2 weeks without so much as one lion sign. No tracks, no scrapes, no scat. 20 of the beautiful cats had been radio-collared, and in less than 3 years, all but 2 had left the park or slipped their collars, disappeared from the radio scanner's range somehow. Ranchers around the Guadalupes swore the park was a breeding ground for the varmints, and that cattle were being slaughtered by the cats. But Anna had never so much as glimpsed a mountain lion in the 2 years she'd been a law enforcement ranger at Guadalupe. And she spent more than half her time wandering the high country, sitting under the ponderosa pines, walking the white limestone trails, lying under the limitless Texas sky. Never had she seen a cougar. And if wishing and waiting and watching could have made it so, prides of the great padding beasts would have crossed her path. This, between her feet, was probably coyote scat. Because she hated to go home empty-handed, Anna dutifully measured, recorded, and photographed the little heap of dung. She wished all wild creatures were as adaptable as the coyote. Trickster, the Indians called him. Indeed he must be to thrive so close to man. Piled next to the coyote's mark was the unmistakable reddish, berry-filled scat of the ring-tailed cat. My ravine, it declared. My canyon. I was here second. Anna laughed. Your canyon, she agreed aloud. I'm for home. Stretching tired muscles, she craned her neck in a backward arc. Overhead, just to the east, vultures turned tight circles, corkscrewing up from the creek bed between the narrow walls of the middle McKittrick Canyon where she hiked. 11 of the big birds spun in a lazy whirlwind of beaks and feathers. Whatever they hovered over was hidden from view by the steep cliffs of the Permian Reef. A scrap of rotting carrion the size of a goose egg drew vultures, but 11? 11 was too many. Damn, Anna whispered. A deer had probably broken a leg and coyotes had gotten it. Probably. A 12th winged form joined the hungry waiting dance. Damn. Anna pulled up her pack and shrugged into it. You can have your rock back, she addressed the apparently empty crevice, and started down the canyon. While she'd been sitting, the glaring white of the stones that formed the floor of Middle McKittrick Canyon had been softened to pale gold. Shadows were growing long. Lizards crept to the top of the rocks to catch the last good sun of the day. A tarantula, the size of a woman's hand, the most horrifying of gentle creatures, wandered slowly across Anna's path. As a park ranger, I will protect and serve you. She talked to the creature from a safe 3 yards away. But we'll never be friends. Is that going to be a problem? The tarantula stopped, its front pair of legs feeling the air. Then it turned and walked slowly toward her, each of its legs appearing to move independently of the other seven. Yes, I see that it is. Glad there were no visitors to witness her absurdity, Anna stepped aside and gave the magnificent bug a wider berth than science or good sense would have deemed necessary. Half a mile further down the canyon, the walls began to narrow around boulders the size of Volkswagens. Anna scrambled and jumped from one to the next. Middle McKittrick was an excellent place to break an ankle or a neck. Join the buzzard's buffet. The sun slipped lower, and the canyon filled with shadow. In the sudden cooling, a breeze sprang up, carrying with it a new smell. Not the expected sickly sweet odor of rotting flesh, but the fresh smell of water, unmistakable in the desert, always startling. One never grew accustomed to miracles. Energized, Anna walked on. The walls became steeper, towering more than 60 feet above the creek. A rugged hillside of catclaw and agave showed dark above the pale cliffs. The boulders that littered Upper McKittrick were no longer in evidence. In the canyon's heart, Anna walked on smooth limestone. Over the ages, water had scoured a deep trough, then travertine, percolating out of the solution, lined it with a natural cement. Not a good place to be caught during the Texas monsoons in July and August. Each time she walked this transect in search of cougar sign, Anna had that same thought. And each time she had the same perverse stab of excitement, hoping one day to see the power and the glory that could roll half a mountain aside as it thundered through. The smell of water grew stronger, and mixed with the sighing and sawing of the wind, she could hear its delicate music. Potholes began pitting the stream bed, signs of recent flooding. Recent in geological time, far too long to wait for a drink. Some of the scoured pits were 30 feet across and 20 feet deep. A litter of leaves and bones lay at the bottom of the one Anna skirted. An animal, a fawn by the look of one of the intact leg bones, had fallen in and been unable to climb out again. This was a section of the canyon that Anna hated to hike, though its austere beauty lured her back time and again. The high walls, with their steep sloping shoulders, sliding down to slick-sided pits, put a clutch in her stomach. Further down, the white basins would be filled with crystal waters, darting yellow sunfish. Life. But here the river had deserted the canyon for a world underground and left only these oddly sculpted death traps. Anna entertained no false hopes that her radio signal would reach up over the cliffs and mountains to summon help if she were to lose her footing. She crawled the distance on hands and knees. Even heralded by perfume and music, the water took her by surprise. Sudden in the bleak, bone-white canyon came an emerald pool filled by a fall of purest water. The plop of fleeing frogs welcomed her, and she stopped a moment just to marvel. Aware of the ache across her shoulders, Anna loosed the straps and let her pack fall heavily to the limestone. At the abrupt sound, there was an answering rattle, a rushing sound that brought her heart to her throat. With a crackling of black feathered wings and a chatter of startled cries, a cloud of vultures fought up out of the sawgrass that grew along the bench on the south side of the pool. They didn't fly far, but settled in soot-colored heaps along the ledges, looking jealously back at their abandoned feast. Anna looked to where they fixed their sulky eyes. Sawgrass, three-sided and sharp, grew nearly shoulder-high along the ledge beyond the pool. From a distance, the dark green blades, edged with a paler shade, looked soft, lush. But Anna knew from experience anything edible in this dark land had ways of protecting itself. Each blade of sawgrass was edged with fine teeth, like the serrated edge of a metal-cutting saw. The sand-colored stone above it was dark, with seeps of water weeping from the cliff's face. Ferns, an anomaly in the desert, hung in a green haze from the rocks, and violets the size of Anna's thumbnail sparked the stone with purple. In the grasses, then, protected by their razor sides, was the carrion supper she had stumbled upon. Not anxious to wade through the defending vegetation, Anna reached to roll down her sleeves to protect the skin of her arms. Fingers touched only flesh, and she remembered with irritation that though, come sunset, West Texas still hovered in the cool grip of spring, the National Park Service had declared summer had arrived. Long-sleeved uniform shirts had been banned on May 1st. Balancing easily on the sloped stone, now that the drop was softened with a shimmer of water, Anna walked to the edge of the pool and entered the sawgrass. She held her hands above her head like a teenager on a roller coaster. The sharp grasses snagged at her trouser legs, plucked her shirt tight against her body. It matted underfoot, and in places grew taller than the top of her head. Her boots sank to the laces in the mire. Water seeped in, soaked through her socks. A high-pitched, throaty sound grumbled from her perching audience. "I'm not going to eat your damned carrion," Anna reassured them with ill grace. "I just want to see if it's a lion kill." Even as she spoke, she wondered if talking to turkey vultures was a worse sign, mentally speaking, than talking to oneself. She must remember to ask Molly. At the next step, stink, trapped by the grasses, rose in an almost palpable cloud. Death seemed to rot the very air. In a sharp, choking gasp, Anna sucked it into her lungs. Crumpled amongst the thick stems was the green and gray of a National Park Service uniform. Sheila Drury, the Dog Canyon Ranger, lay half-curled, knees drawn up. An iridescent green and black backpack, heavy with water and whatever was inside, twisted her almost belly up. Buzzard buffet. They didn't even have to dig for the tastiest parts. Anna knew Drury only to say hello to. The woman had been with the park just 7 months. Now she lay at Anna's feet, her entrails, plucked loose by greedy talons, decorating her face, tangling in her brown hair. Mercifully, the thick, loose tresses covered the dead eyes, veiled the lower half of the face and neck. One vulture, bolder than the rest, dropped down from the ledge on widespread wings, stirring up the putrid air. Unheralded, a Gary Larson cartoon flashed into Anna's brain. Vultures around a kill. "Ooh-wee, this thing's been here a long time. Well, thank God for ketchup." Gagging, Anna turned and stumbled toward the pool. Razor-thin lines of red appeared on her face and arms with a sawgrass cut. Oblivious to their sting, she fought free of the vegetation. Her stomach was long emptied before the heaving stopped. She crawled to the water's edge, wiped her mouth with a handkerchief wet from the pool, and, without hope, pulled her King radio from its leather holster on the hip belt of her pack. 311-315. Three times she tried. Magic number, she thought, filling her mind with irrelevancies. The Holy Trinity. Three wishes, three strikes, and you're out. No contact. 315 clear. The vultures had settled back to their interrupted supper. A squabble of black wings pulled Anna's reluctant attention to the sawgrass. A shadow rose into the sky. Something slippery and snake-like held fast in its talons. Another followed, snatching at the prize. Not such a bad thing, Anna couldn't help thinking, to be so celebrated in passing. Half the naturalists in the park would be honored to play to such an appreciative audience. Sorry, Sheila, she said aloud, knowing few shared her strange sensibilities. I'll be as quick as I can. She belted the radio on and, looking only where she put her hands, began to climb. Daggers of agave, needles sharp and thrusting, knife-like up from the rocky soil, catclaw in a bushy haze of tangled branches and small hooked spines, and jagged tooth sotol, the black sheep of the lily family, tore at her skin and clothing. These dragons of this tiny Eden were the reason it had yet to be trammeled by humanity in the form of coolers full of beer and sunbathers slathered with cocoa butter. 40 or 50 yards above the canyon bottom, Anna found a secure niche between a rock and a stunted yucca, clinging determinedly to the thin layer of soil. 311-315, she repeated. This time, there was the reassuring static surge of the radio transmission hitting the repeater on Bush Mountain. 311, came Paul Decker's familiar voice. Much to her surprise, Anna began to cry. The relief of that comforting sound had momentarily undone her. Paul, the Frijoli District Ranger, always answered. Always, on duty or off. There was even a radio in his bathroom. Paul, Anna, she said, unnecessarily, giving herself time. I'm about an hour north of where Middle and North McKittrick fork. We've had an incident. I'll need a litter and enough people to carry it out. She knew better than to hope for a helicopter. The nearest was in El Paso, 2 hours away. A body basket could be dropped down from a helicopter, but it would take a very long line. Dangerous in such treacherous country. Never risk the living for the dead. The victim is... Is what? Anna's mind raced for the radio-approved double talk for dead. Dispatched was the word of choice when a ranger had had to kill a creature, human or otherwise. But an already dispatched ranger being consumed by turkey vultures? The victim is non-salvageable, she said, falling back on her ambulance triage protocol. An alarming silence followed. Paul, do you copy? She asked anxiously. 10-4, came the automatic reply. Then, Anna, it's too late to get anyone up to you tonight. Can you hang in there till morning? Anna said yes, and 315 clear. Wishing there was more to say, wishing the tenuous contact could be prolonged, she dropped her radio back into its leather holster. At first light, Paul would start out. In her mind's ears, she could hear him digging his search and rescue kit out of the hall closet. Probably he would sleep as little as she did. He was that sort of man. Once, when alcohol and memories had kept her up late, she'd seen him creeping out of his house at 3 a.m. to count vehicles, making sure all his little seasonal employees had made it out of the high country and were safe in their beds. Anna breathed deeply and leaned back against the pitted stone. At this height, there was still sun to the west. Rich and red, it slipped toward Guadalupe Peak, the highest point in Texas. Texans, Anna thought, though she loved them with a pinch of salt and a lot of laughter, were full of shit. But when it came to the sky, they weren't just whistling Dixie. The Texas sky was something else. Sunsets of gold and crimson, stars to dazzle, clouds taller than the fabled Stetsons. Thunderclouds were beginning to build to the north and west. There'd been lightning the previous night over Dog Canyon. Anna had watched it from her camp on the ridge between Dog and Middle McKittrick. It was the first storm of the season, all lightning and no precipitation. The weather pattern would continue that way till the rains came in July. Fire danger was high. Already, fires burned half a dozen places in New Mexico and Arizona. Everyone in the park was on the lookout for smokes. Red-gold fingers of light reached through the dry thunderheads, touching the desert with the illusion of living green, a green that would come with the monsoons. 724 Echo is 10-7. The baby voice of the Carlsbad Caverns dispatcher startled Anna back from the clean peace of the sky. Carlsbad was going out of service late, leaving the cave with the bats. Fortunately, there was still plenty of light to work her way down to the creek bed. She had no food for supper, but something had spoiled her appetite anyway. Down was worse than up. Gravity, eager to help, dragged at her every misstep. But she made it, stood solidly on the smooth limestone, water at her feet, a corpse in the sawgrass. Anna tried to call the Dog Canyon Ranger to mind. Sheila Drury, 29, 30, 35, female, Caucasian, park ranger, recently deceased. The woman had entered on duty in December the year before. In the 7 months since, she'd caused quite a stir. There'd been a lot of repercussions when she had proposed building recreational vehicle sites at Dog, and she'd raised a lot of fuss and furor over a plan to reintroduce prairie dogs into the area. Politics and gossip were all that Anna knew of her. Dog Canyon District was 2 hours by car from the Frijole District. They'd never had an occasion to work together. Too late to get to know her now, Anna thought, dryly. Heaven and the vultures only knew what would be left come sunrise. Not for the first time, Anna wished she'd learned more natural history. Did vultures feed all night? Would she hear the grumbling, plucking sounds in the coming dark? She dug her headlamp from her pack and pulled it tight across her brow. Clues. That's what the law enforcement specialists at FLETC, the school in Georgia, had taught her to look for. Clues. Bloody fingerprints. Cars parked in strange places. White powder trickling out of trunks. In the more populous parks, like Glen Canyon and Yosemite, or those close to urban areas, as were Joshua Tree or Smoky Mountains, crime was more prevalent. In fleeing Manhattan and her memories, Anna had kept to out-of-the-way places. So far, all she'd had to deal with in the line of duty were dogs off-leash and Boy Scouts camping out of bounds. Still in all, she was a federally commissioned law enforcement officer. She would look for clues, however nauseating. Chapter 2. Anna fished two of the soggy lemon slices from her water bottle, mashed them to a pulp, and rubbed the pulp into her wet handkerchief. Tying it over her mouth and nose, she fervently hoped it would cut the stench of death down to a tolerable level. Next, she took the camera she'd been using on the lion transect and hung it around her neck. Switching on the headlamp, though it wasn't yet dark enough to do her much good, she waded into the sawgrass. The camera helped. It gave her distance. Through its lens, she was able to see more clearly. Sheila Drury was parceled out into photographic units. As she clicked, Anna made mental notes. No scrapes, no bruises, no twisted limbs. Drury probably hadn't fallen. Freaks of nature did happen now and then. Anna looked up at the cliff above, imagined Drury falling, dying instantly on impact. No contusions. Unlikely enough, even if Catclaw 8 and 10 feet high hadn't tangled close along the edge, why would she fight cross-country through it in a full pack? Anna turned her attention back to the corpse. The skin of the face and arms was clear, smooth, the tongue unswollen. The Dog Canyon Ranger hadn't died of hunger, thirst, or exposure. Anna had more or less ruled those out anyway. Guadalupe Mountains National Park, though rugged and unforgiving, was barely 12 miles across. For a ranger familiar with the country to stay lost long enough to perish from the elements was highly improbable. Two, one presumed Drury had water, food, the stuff of survival, in her pack. A tent and sleeping bag were strapped on the outside. No obvious powder burns, bullet holes, or stabbing wounds. Evidently, the woman had not been waylaid by drug runners hiding in the wilderness. Despite the tragic situation, Anna smiled. Edith, her mother-in-law, a veteran of the Bronx, but darling, it was very middle class in the 40s, of the Great Depression, the number two train from Wall Street, and World War II, stood aghast at the concept of a woman camping alone in the wilderness. Anna, there's nobody there. Anyone could be there. Anna believed the truth was, alone was safe. A woman alone would live the longest. Criminals were a lazy bunch. If they weren't, they'd get their MBAs and rob with impunity. They most assuredly wouldn't walk 8 hard miles to hide. They'd check into a Motel 6 on the interstate, watch afternoon TV, and hope for the best. What did that leave, she wondered, her eye once again against the viewfinder. Suicide? A bit odd to do oneself in full gear in a sawgrass swamp. Heart attack? Stroke? Drowning? Lots of ways to die. Suddenly Anna felt fragile. Evening was settling into the canyon's bottom. Soon she'd be wasting film. 3 pictures left on the roll. Careful not to disturb anything, Anna leaned down and drew the curtain of heavy, dark hair from Sheila Drury's face and throat. There it was. Another way to die. Oddly, the last and the first she had considered. Lion kill. Claw marks cut up from Drury's clavicle to her chin. Puncture wounds, claws or teeth, made neat dark holes above the collarbone. Anna did not doubt that Sheila's neck had been snapped as well. It was the way the big cats made their kills. For a long moment, Anna stood, the dead woman at her feet, oblivious to the gathering darkness. Tears welling from deep inside spilled down her face and dripped from the square line of her jaw. Now the lions would be hunted down and killed. Now every trigger-happy Texan would blast away at every tawny shadow that flickered in the brush. The government's bounty quotas on predators of domestic livestock would go up. Lions would die and die. "Damn you, Drury," Anna whispered, as ways to obscure the evidence appeared in and were discarded from her mind. "What in hell were you doing here?" Steeling herself to accept the touch of dead flesh, Anna felt down Drury's jaw and neck, then lifted her arm. Rigor had already passed off. She'd been dead a while. Since sometime Friday afternoon or night, Anna guessed. Her light trained on the ground, she moved past the body. Above Drury's head were 2 perfect paw prints. Behind them, several feet, were 2 more. Anna measured the distance with her eyes. A big lion. Soon stars would begin to appear in the silver-gray ribbon of sky overhead. Before the shadowy tracks vanished in the growing gloom, she clicked a couple pictures of the prints and one last shot of the body. There was no more film, no more to be done till morning. Aware of how desperately tired she was, Anna readjusted her headlamp to light her footsteps and trudged out of the sawgrass. It seemed all she could do to drag one foot after the other. The vultures did not drop down in her wake to resume their meal. Evidently, the big birds did not feed at night. Anna was grateful. Notwithstanding her appreciation of the food chain, she wasn't sure she could have stood a night listening to its graphic demonstration. The sepulchral snacking would have been unsettling, to say the least. Wearily, she wondered why the lion hadn't eaten more of its kill, eviscerated it, as lions usually did. Something must have frightened it off. Perhaps a hiker, unaware that less than 15 yards away, a corpse lay in the grasses, a lion hunkered by. The canyon was closed, but occasionally hikers did wander in. Surely in this dry season, with game so scarce, the lion would return. It might be nearby, waiting. One of the forsworn gods' little jokes, to have Anna's long-coveted first lion sighting be her last sight on this earth. Anna didn't know if she was scared or not. She supposed she was, because she found herself groping through her pack to curl her fingers around the cold comfort of her .357 Smith & Wesson service revolver. It was hard to be philosophical in the night. There was something too primeval in the closeness of death. To her surprise, she was hungry. Life reasserting its claim, insisting on its rights and privileges. There was probably food in Drury's pack, but Anna wasn't that hungry. Vultures watching a lion watching her hunt for the food their food was carrying. The chain grew too tangled. Sheila Drury, was she watching as well? Anna didn't have to believe in God to wonder where people's spirits went when they died. Wonder if hers would go there, too. Ghost stories from childhood crept uninvited into her thoughts, and she found herself afraid to look toward the sawgrass, afraid she'd see not a lion, but a floating wraith. With a physical shake of her shoulders, Anna pushed the night's terrors from her. Since Zack had died, and every night had been a night alone, she learned to put away fear. Those nights, she remembered, she'd prayed for a ghost, a voice, a touch, anything. There was nothing then, and nothing now, except a hungry night, and perhaps a hungry lion. Darkness closed on this rattling of thoughts. Overhead, the stream of stars grew deeper. Cold air settled into the canyon, flowed around her where she sat, knees drawn up. 357 by her side, staring into the melting mirror of the pool. At some point, Anna dug out the 4 Ritz crackers, the last chocolate pudding, and a half a handful of gorp from her backpack, and ate them. At some point, after moonrise, when a light, unseasonal rain began to fall, she unrolled her sleeping bag and crawled into it. At some point, though she would have denied it, Anna slept. Chapter 3. Wincing at the sting of water in the paper-thin sawgrass cuts on her hands and arms, Anna slid down in the bath. Not a great bath, by any means. Great baths had gone out with clawfoot tubs. The passion for showers that had replaced them with prefab white plastic boxes at the bottom of featureless stalls was incomprehensible to Anna. In New York, she'd lain for hours in the tub in the kitchen of a 5-floor walk-up in Hell's Kitchen, making pictures from the water stains on the ceiling, and waiting for Zack to come home and make the wait worth her while. Always he came home. Sometimes he made love to her. Sometimes he didn't. Rogelio always did, whether she wanted him to or not. Anna wondered what time it was, wondered if he would come, wondered if she cared, and took another sip of wine. Mondavi Red, her Vin Ordinaire. It was cheap, came in big bottles, traveled well in a backpack, and didn't taste half bad. Sipping again, she enjoyed the feeling of heat within and heat without, unknotting her mind. Piedmont sat just outside the bathroom door. His eyes glowed red in the light of the single candle. His thick, yellow-striped tail was curled neatly over his forepaws. Piedmont liked the sound of running water. Anna thought it was because he was probably born of a feral mother near the banks of the Black River, somewhere down by Rattlesnake Springs. He would never come near the tub, though. Perhaps because he'd half-drowned in a flash flood. After the monsoon's worst cloudburst, the July before, Anna had found him tangled in dead branches in the crotch of a tree. The cat closed his eyes, going into his river trance. Anna's gaze moved to the candlelight on the bathwater, then idly down the length of her body. At 39, she still retained her boyish figure, but her skin didn't fit quite so snugly as it once had. Elbows, knees, neck, wherever the bending went on, there were wrinkles. Her muscles, better defined than when she was 20, were beginning to look ropey. Still, it was a good body, even in the face of the changing physical fashions touted in the glossy magazines. She'd always liked it fine. A strong body, easy to maintain. The water was unknotting her hair, unweaving the copper and the silver strands from the single braid she kept them locked in and spreading them around her shoulders like seaweed. Ophelia drowned, Anna thought. Or, in the New York theatrical agent's parlance of Molly's Friday 10 o'clock, an old Ophelia type. A dead woman. What was left of Sheila Drury had been wrapped in garbage bags. The park, bless its optimistic little heart, didn't boast a body bag. The green, shiny bundle that had once been the Dog Canyon Ranger had been loaded onto a Stokes litter, a rolling wire mesh stretcher, and trundled, carried, and wrestled down the stone-filled canyons. Paul had been consummately professional. Anna had tried to appear that way, though 100 exceedingly tasteless jokes had stampeded through her mind during the long trek out. The seasonals, two naturalists and a ranger, who had come to assist, were mostly quiet and sensible. The naturalists were both men, Craig Eastern and Manny Mankins. Cheryl Light was the seasonal law enforcement ranger. A high percentage of National Park Service employees were summer seasonals. Winter found Guadalupe Mountains down to a skeleton staff. Most of the seasonals were highly educated. A number had advanced degrees. Some had families to support. Yet they left jobs and homes and husbands and wives for the privilege of living in a dormitory and working for $6.54 an hour. No retirement. No benefits, and rent deducted automatically. Many hoped, one day, to become permanent, but the openings were few and closely guarded by tangled thickets of red tape. Anna knew Manny had been trying to get on permanently since his son was born 4 years before. Craig Eastern's situation was a little different. He was a herpetologist on a 2-year detail from the University of Texas at El Paso. Anna had been surprised Paul had brought Craig up Middle McKittrick. A shaky, easily alarmed man in his early 30s, Eastern was more at home with rattlesnakes, lizards, and toads than he was with people. He viewed most of humanity askance. The world was being destroyed by humans. The Guadalupe Mountains were the last bastion of untrammeled earth. Anna had to admit that under pressure, he bore up well, admirably even. Seeing Craig lift the corpse onto the stokes, Anna had noticed how muscular he was. His nervousness made him seem like a little man, but he was far from it. Craig Eastern had been working out with weights for years by the look of him. Manny Mankins was the opposite. The wiry naturalist was a man of small stature who seemed a great deal bigger than he was. Bantam cock, Anna's mother-in-law would have called him. Anna had fought fire alongside the skinny, sandy-haired man for 17 days. He'd worked everyone into the ground. That was on the Foolhen fire in Idaho. They'd slammed fire line 22 hours straight. Manny was still cracking jokes, swinging a Pulaski when the rest of the crew was barely scraping theirs over the duff. The bath was growing tepid. Anna pushed the hot water on with her big toe, poured herself another glass of Cabernet from the bottle on the toilet seat. Settling back in physical content, she let the image of the seasonal law enforcement ranger drift behind her half-closed eyes. Cheryl Light was new to the park, entering on duty only a couple of weeks before. Stocky, around 5'5" and maybe 150 pounds, with shoulder-length permed hair. Anna placed her age somewhere between 35 and 45. With woodsy types, it was hard to tell. Their skin wrinkled prematurely from sun and weather, but their vitality was ageless. Usually Cheryl laughed a lot. The kind of laugh that made others laugh, too, even before they knew what the joke was. There'd been no laughter that day. Cheryl had carried Drury's pack, and over the rough spots, one end of the stoke's litter. The woman was powerful, but that's not what stuck in Anna's mind. What had impressed her was the unobtrusive way Cheryl had supported, eased, bolstered, comforted, bucked up everybody around her. Apparently she did it without effort or even knowledge that she was doing it. A well-timed smile, a touch, a proffered drink from her water bottle. Anna envied it. Kindness, true unadulterated kindness, was beyond her. If Cheryl's kindness was legitimate, Anna's resident cynic interjected the customary sour note. Unadulterated altruistic kindness, it went against the grain. Still in all, it was kindness. I think too much to be kind, she excused herself to a disinterested cat. Had Cheryl found a way to laugh about it by now? Though she and Craig and Manny were all business at the scene, there would be jokes tonight after a few beers and maybe, for Craig, some nightmares. Probably Anna wouldn't hear much about it, and Paul, nothing. Everyone pretended there was no wall between the permanent National Park Service employees and the seasonals, and everyone knew there was. A veritable bureaucratic Jericho with no Joshua in sight. Everyone was transient. Seasonals came and went like stray cats. Even permanent employees seldom stayed in one place more than a few years, not if they wanted to advance their careers. People who homesteaded, stayed in one park too long, tended to come to think of the place as theirs. They developed their own ideas of how it should be run. The NPS didn't care for that. It made people less tractable, less willing to follow party line, dictated from half a continent away. Carl Johnson, the man who tended Guadalupe's stock, had been with the Park Service for 15 years, yet he'd never been promoted higher than GS-5, the grade of a beginning seasonal. His love of these mountains had cost him a lot. Sometimes Anna wondered if it wasn't worth it. Personally, the dashing from place to place made for unsettled lives, professionally, for duplicated paperwork and unfinished projects. And the death of Sheila Drury, was it finished? Anna had been amazed at how little time the official investigation had taken. Benjamin Jakey, a sheriff out of El Paso, and one of his deputies, a Pillsbury doughboy look-alike who'd never stopped puffing from the hike in, had done some perfunctory poking around. Yep, lion got her. Surprised it don't happen more often, Sheriff Jakey said. And the deputy puffed portentously. Jakey had looked through the grass, gone over the sketches Anna had made of the scene. The deputy shot a couple rolls of film and told Anna they wouldn't need hers. That had been about it. The feds would have it now. The park was federal land, but they would rubber stamp it, Anna assumed. Everyone would be surprised here in the wilderness that lion kills didn't happen more often. More often, Anna said aloud. More often than what? More often than never? Than once a decade? What? She must remember to find out come morning, and come morning she had to write a witness statement for the county coroner, Nina Dietz. It was she they had delivered the body to. Looking more like Aunt Bee than the keeper of the dead, she'd been waiting with the ambulance in the McKittrick Visitor's Center parking lot. She'd ridden with Paul as he'd driven the body away. No more Sheila Drury. And one day, no more Anna Pigeon. It was a sobering thought. Anna took a deep drink of her wine. The front door opened, then clicked softly shut again. Piedmont slunk away to hide under the kitchen table. Anna heard a tape drop into the boombox. Guy Clark's Rita Ballou. Rogelio. Now, for a while, there would be other things to think about. Anna. A tap on the bathroom door.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.